Hello, my name is Judith Cuypers. I'm one of the congenital cardiologists in our center, and I'm going to tell you about the issue of congenital heart disease, your group of colleagues who is working to provide and improve the care for congenital heart disease patients. Well, first I would like to tell you a little bit about what congenital heart defects are. They are among the most common congenital defects, and they make about one third of all congenital defects. And about 8 in every 1,000 babies is born with a congenital heart defect. And you can see a graph of the birth prevalence of congenital heart defects on the right side of the slide, in which all the birth prevalence of all the parts of the world is described. Well, the heart is developed in the first 7 weeks of gestation, and the heart starts out as a tube, which has to fold and then twist a bit to make sure that every compartment of the heart is developed and every septum is formed and all the valves are formed in the normal places. And you can imagine that sometimes something goes wrong in this development and the septum is not formed completely, and there will be a hole where there shouldn't be a hole, or a valve is not developed normally, or even completely absent, or something goes wrong with the arrangement of the great vessels of the heart. So there are many different types of congenital heart disease, and they can be very mild, like a little hole in a septum, what can even close spontaneously still after birth. Until on the other end of the spectrum, a heart which has developed only half with one ventricle and or absent valves, and they will be very severe heart diseases, which you cannot stay alive with without any operation. And about 50% of all babies who are born with a congenital heart defect will need surgery to survive. Well, before it was possible to operate on congenital heart disease, only one quarter of, or up to one quarter of all babies born with heart disease did not survive their first years of life. And only 15% managed to make it till their 18th birthday. So they didn't even grow up all the time. Very few of them grew up to be adults. Well, nowadays, after the introduction of the cardiac surgery and all the improvements that have been made, over 95% reaches adult age. So that is something, but that's not everything. I'm going to tell you more about that later, but first I would like to show you this graph of the survival in patients with tetralogy of Fallot. Without explaining what it exactly is, you must know that it's quite a severe congenital heart defect with cyanosis, which is not compatible with a long life without having any surgery. And in this graph, you can see that survival up to the 18th birthday was very low before we could do anything about it. And then at first, there was the introduction of shunts, making blood flow through the lungs, which is a problem in this defect, better. That gave a little bit of improvement, as you can see here. But the real improvement came after the introduction of cardiac surgery, after which you could do a complete repair of the disease. Well, this spectacular improvement in survival up to adulthood has led to a growing population of patients with congenital heart disease, and the number of adults in the world with congenital heart disease or repaired congenital heart disease has now become greater than the amount of children, because, well, once they turn 18, they go to the other side, the adult population, of course. And in the Netherlands, we have now around 25,000 children living with congenital heart disease and about 50,000 adults. Well, they have to be taken care of by very specialized doctors, and they are taken care of by pediatric cardiologists when they're young, by adult congenital cardiologists like me when they're older, and of course the cardiac surgeons who have to operate on them. And we work in very close collaboration, not only with those three specialties, but also with the clinical geneticists, with the radiology department, some subspecialized cardiology departments, as you can see in this graph over here. And due to all the improvements that have been made, the focus of our care has shifted from mere survival to quality of life afterwards. Well, the growing population is nicely represented in this graph. This is the number of outpatient clinic visits in our adult congenital heart disease outpatient clinic. And you can see that we started in 1991 and then we had about 500 patients a year who visited our outpatient clinic. And over the years until now, we have about 5,000 consultations per year. Well, the goals of our ACE, as you can see here, are to provide the best possible care for our patients, starting before they're born and going on all the way until they hopefully achieve very old age in one center. And we focus on outcome and quality of life, especially. Further, we will do research to promote their quality of life and to reduce the morbidity and mortality even further. And of course, we have to educate our students and our colleagues and future colleagues to help us take the best care of these patients. And even we sometimes educate our patients themselves. Last year, we had an online webinar about our field of work, specially made for patients. Well, congenital heart defects are not always immediately detected. It would be best if we detect them before a patient is born, before a baby is born. And nowadays, everybody who is pregnant will have their fetal ultrasound, and we can study the heart in that too, and the more gross congenital heart defects will be discovered in such an investigation. But sometimes it's missed, and then you can have a baby who is not growing like they should, or is cyanotic, and then that could be a clue to find out they have congenital heart disease. But sometimes it's detected later in life, later during childhood or even in adult age. You can imagine that a smaller abnormality in the heart will not cause very many hemodynamic problems at first, but in the long term, even a very small hole in a septum, like an atrial septal defect or a ventricular septal defect, can lead to pulmonary hypertension or arrhythmias. Well, the repair of congenital heart defects can be either surgical, that was the first way to treat these defects, but nowadays we can also do many treatments through catheter-based therapies. And you can see some examples over here. This is an example of the placement of a heart valve through a catheter-based procedure. This is, I don't know if you can see it on the screen very much, but here is a little septal closure device, which can be placed in the same kind of procedure. And this is a picture of the stenting of a coarctation of the aorta, which is a narrowing of the aorta, which had to be operated in the early days of surgery, but nowadays can be treated through a catheter therapy. Well, after repair has been performed, does that mean that the patient is cured? Well, in the first years of cardiac surgery, people were very optimistic and they thought that it would be a cure for life. But we learned kind of the hard way that it was not the case. And nowadays we know that patients with congenital heart disease can have late complications. And what you have to think of then is that there can be residual or recurrent defects like valve problems, which develop after repair, and they may cause the necessity to have a reintervention. But you can also think of arrhythmias due to the hemodynamic consequences of the defects themselves, or due to the scars of the surgery that can lead to re-entry tachycardias. Also, heart failure can occur, especially in patients who had their surgery a little later than would be ideal, and or because of damage that was done during the operation. And also the chance of having sudden cardiac death in patients with congenital heart disease is higher than in the general population. And all this together makes that the life expectancy of people with congenital heart disease in general is decreased compared to the general population. Well, this that does not only lead to medical problems, but also to other issues, because when you don't have a normal life expectancy, or when somebody thinks that you don't have a normal life expectancy, then it's a little more can be more difficult to have a life insurance, or to get a mortgage, or to get a job, or to perform a physical activity that you want to do. In our ACE, we aim to improve the quality of life and the longevity of life for congenital heart disease patients by doing research to promote this, as I said before. And these are the topics that we are doing research about. We are describing the long-term outcome, as you can see on top of the list, and try to identify predictors for outcome to have a better selection in the future, which patient we should follow up more closely than others. One good example of that is the Rotterdam Quality of Life study, of which I'm going to tell you more about in a few minutes. We also try to identify biomarkers that can be prognosticators for future developments. The Biocon study is a good example of that. We try to improve our diagnostic tools to discover mild or subtle changes in cardiac function or in valve function earlier, so that we can plan re-interventions or treatment earlier than we do now. And the echocardiography and cardiac MR are the main topics of these diagnostic investigations. And we try to improve the quality of life and the life expectancy by all these researches. And because patients are getting older and older, they reach their adult lives and they want to start families. And yeah, sometimes it can be a bit more riskful to have a pregnancy in a woman with heart disease, with, for example, diminished ventricular function or severe valve problems. And that's why we do research about pregnancy in patients with congenital heart disease as well. The Rotterdam Quality of Life study is a study that we perform here, and it's a kind of unique study in the world, in which we follow the cohort of patients who were operated in the first era of congenital heart surgery here in Rotterdam between 1968 and 1980. We follow all the children who were operated for their congenital heart disease before the age of 15. And we follow them every 10 years. We started doing this in 1990, and we currently are performing our fourth reinvestigation. And all these patients, or at least the five big groups of the same diagnosis, are followed, and they have a complete medical investigation every 10 years, and also a very extensive psychosocial investigation by questionnaires and a specialized interview, talking about their quality of life, their sports activities, sports participation, about pregnancy and problems that they experience with it, or and this last round we are also looking into neuropsychological problems which may arise because of their history of congenital heart disease. And by analyzing all these results, we try to find predictors for outcome. This slide is showing the survival and the event-free survival of the five groups of patients that we follow in this Rotterdam study. And the slide on the left side, as you can see here, is the cumulative survival. If you look very closely, you can see a black line here on top of the graph, and that's the line of the general population, the survival in the general population up to 40 years of age, 40 years of follow-up after the surgery of our patient. In the legend, you can see first the Dutch general population again, and then the five groups, which you don't have to completely understand what it means, but from top to bottom, it's mild congenital heart disease and still a little bit worse until severe congenital heart disease. And you can see that in the mild forms of congenital heart disease, the survival is quite good. In the red line is even almost the same as the general population. But in the more severe defects, the survival is clearly less than normal. You can also see that there was quite some, or at least compared to the nowadays results, there was a little perioperative mortality was higher than was quite high in some groups. Well, that's a complete survival is quite okay, I would say. But then you can see in the left in the right-sided graph that the event-free survival is much worse. Even in the groups with mild congenital heart defects, you can see that quite a percentage of the patients has long-term complications. And you can see that in the patients with fallot and Mustard repair, which are severe congenital heart defects, that long-term complications are very frequent. And in the green line, almost 80% of the whole group has had some complication after 40 years of follow-up. Well, which complications are we talking about? You don't have to look at all the numbers in this slide in detail because it's a bit too busy, but we represented the severity of congenital heart disease in increasing order. So mild heart disease until severe congenital heart disease. And you can see that we looked at supraventricular, at arrhythmias, at pacemaker implantation, at ICD implantation, and heart failure. Well, heart failure and ventricular arrhythmias are not very frequent or not occurring at all in the mild congenital heart defect, but especially in the last column, you can see that almost a quarter of the patients had heart failure after 40 years of follow-up. Well, these complications do occur, but does that mean that these patients do have a very bad quality of life? Well, actually, it doesn't. In the same study, as I told you, we are looking at the psychosocial outcome and also the quality of life, and we ask patients to fulfill the SF-36 questionnaire, which looks in eight different domains of psychosocial functioning. And these graphs are representing four of the groups. It was a bit too busy to put the fifth one in, but four of these groups that we study, you must know that the blue bars are representing the scores of this SF-36 questionnaire in patients, and the red bars are the validation in the general population. And in these questionnaires, the higher the score is, the better it is. And you can see that almost all the blue bars are higher than the red bars. So the quality of life, the self-reported quality of life, I forgot to mention, is better in patients than in the general population. I told you that we also look into pregnancy in patients with congenital heart disease, and this is a nice example, the ROBEC study. ROBEC registry is a nice study that was initiated by Professor Roos Hesselink in our department in close collaboration with Roger Hall, a gynecologist in London, and they started with a European study, but as you can see, all the green countries in this world map are participating, and maybe this is already outdated by now, but you can see that it's a worldwide study on the outcome of pregnancy in patients with congenital and other structural heart diseases. Well, of course, I'm not going to sum up all the research that we do, but I made a little collection of the things that the topics that we are investigating and which has have led to nice publications by all the colleagues in our ACE. And you can see that we are examining exercise and the benefit of it for congenital heart disease patients, long-term outcome, pregnancy, psychosocial functioning, and the diagnostic tools that we can use to detect early deterioration. So patients living with congenital heart disease have much better prospects due to the introduction of the cardiac surgery that was started in the 1950s and 60s, but still overall survival is lower than normal, and long-term complications do occur even in the mild forms of congenital heart disease. So lifelong follow-up is necessary by specialized doctors in specialized centers like ours. And you have seen that quality of life in congenital heart disease patients is generally good. And many patients lead quite normal lives. They have a job, they have a family, they have they do participate in sports and all the other things that normal people also do. Sports participation is safe in stable patients with congenital heart disease. Instead of what was thought in the past, many of our patients who are now grown-ups heard in their youthful life that they were taught by their parents or by their doctors that they shouldn't be too much active in sports, and they should not perform too strenuous physical exercise because it may be harmful. But now we know that in stable patients that sport participation can be very beneficial, like in the general population, and we don't have to worry about increased sudden risk death or increased risk for arrhythmia or other complications. And the same goes for pregnancy. In the beginning, after 30 years ago or so, many women with congenital heart disease were told that having kids of their own might be very problematic or might not be safe. But now we know that in many cases, pregnancy can be successful for both mother and child. And of course, we need to risk stratify these women before they get pregnant, because in some cases it can be not very wise to become pregnant. But if you're stable and there are no very serious residual defects, it's often very well possible. Well, thank you for your attention. I hope I gave you a nice overview of our activities in the ACE for congenital cardiology. And I would like to thank all my colleagues who are working with me. Thank you for the attention.